Have you ever wanted to help Godot with code? It is easier than you might expect. Fixing simple bugs or adding quality of life changes can be done even if your C++ knowledge is fairly basic. So here's a guide on everything to expect when contributing code improvements to Godot. Here we'll compile Godot and set up our dev environment, go over the workflow on how to get your code submitted and accepted into Godot. And on the second part, we'll make a new improvement to Godot from scratch and see how it goes. But first, we need a dev environment. So let's see how to properly compile Godot and get one. I'm going to showcase my experience with Windows here, as it is the one that usually has more problems. But there are great steps on how to build on every OS inside the docs. They are very complete and work very well. There are only three requirements to compile Godot: a C++ compiler, Python added to the path, and our buildtools, scones. But you will also need Git installed if you want to contribute any code. So let's get started. Download and install Python to our system. And make sure you have add Python to the path selected. This is important, our scones won't work. I'm using my old Python 3.10.9 version here, but any version beyond 3.6 should work, according to the docs. For Git, I highly recommend you install Git for Windows. It comes with Git Bash, which emulates a Bash terminal on Windows that works really well. After installing it, you can right-click anywhere and choose Open Git Bash here. And you can check if you have Python installed by typing python --version and pressing Enter. And here's where we are going to install scones. Type pip install scones and press Y to confirm if asked. This will automatically install scones into our Python and give you access to the scones command. For those who don't know, scones is a build tool similar to make, but with more detailed ways to configure how your program is compiled. To check if scones has been installed correctly, you can now type scones --version. Now we only need our compiler. You can use MinGW directly, but I will go with Visual Studio's one since we are going to be installing it anyways. If you don't have it already, install Visual Studio 2022. I'm using my old 2019 version here, but this will cause some small problems later, and I'll show you how to fix them. So if you can, it's better to stick with the new version. On the installation, you need to have desktop development with C++ and game development with C++. More specifically, you need this Windows SDK library installed. This will make sure you have all the proper static libraries Godot needs to compile. If you forget to add this in the install, don't worry, you can modify the installation by executing the installer again, or enter Visual Studio and go to Tools, Get Tools and Features, to go to the same screen again. And that's it for the requirements. To be able to contribute to Godot, you need to have a GitHub account, so create one if you don't have one already. Then go to the official Godot repository, and press the fork button to create your very own copy of Godot. You can change its name if you'd like, and press Create Fork. Inside your Godot fork now, click on the green code button and copy the link. If you are unfamiliar with Git and don't have SSH keys, you can select the HTTP version instead. Using this option, we will ask for a GitHub password when pushing the code. Now, go to a folder where you'd like to download Godot and open a Git bash there. Type git clone and paste the link you just copied. This will start cloning, downloading the source code. After it is done, you'll see a Godot folder created. So let's type cd Godot fork to go inside the created directory. And just so you know, Godot files are about 200 megabytes of size. But we also download about a gigabyte of data of Git. This here stores all the historical changes that ever happened to Godot over the years, which is why it's so big. Don't do this yet, but if you just want to compile Godot for yourself, you can type scones platform equals Windows or whatever OS you are using and hit Enter. This will compile a working version of Godot, and it is going to take a while. It heavily depends on how fast and how many threads your CPU have. It is normal to take more than 15 minutes for the first time. For me, it took 29 minutes with my fairly old 8-thread CPU, and it usually takes 1 to 2 minutes the following times, if you haven't modified any core engine features. But we don't just want to compile Godot, so let's prepare our dev environment and compile Godot from there. There are several guides on how to set up your IDE environment in Godot, but since we already installed Visual Studio, let's just use that. Now, inside our Godot project, type scones platform equals Windows, vsproj equals yes, devbuild equals yes. The vsproj option will create a Visual Studio solution instead of compiling Godot, and the devbuild option will make sure debug symbols are enabled, so we can use breakpoints to debug our code later. Hit enter, and some new files will be created. Double-click the godot.sln file to open the Godot project in Visual Studio. Now, if you use Visual Studio 2019, there is a couple of problems to solve here. First, the project files generated here tries to use MSVC 143, which is the compiler that comes with Visual Studio 2022, So if you don't have that installed, you get this message and won't be able to compile. To fix this, close the project and open the vcxprj file with a notepad. Search for the platform toolset line and replace 143 for 142. Save it and open the project again, and the problem should be fixed. But now, if you try to make changes to the code, you might be seeing this error now when pressing enter or saving the file. That's because Godot uses clang-format to make sure the code is automatically formatted to keep the code in the project consistent. So for example, if you don't use spaces in functions, clang-format will automatically add them for you, and a bunch of other formatting rules. The problem is that the rules used by Godot needs a clang-format version 13, and VS 2019 comes with version 12. So we need to update that. One easy way to update it without having to download the whole clang is to download a plugin called PowerTools. It contains an updated version of the clang format inside. Then go to Tools, Options, Text Editor, C++, Code Style, Formatting, and set the path to a custom clang format executable. If you decided to install the extension, the file should be in your local data folder. On Windows, it is on your app data local, inside your Visual Studio extensions folder. But you can also just open the v6 file directly and just take the clang format from there. Any of those options will work. Now, you can make changes to the code, and Visual Studio will automatically format it to the style defined in the Godot project file. And we can finally compile Godot. Make sure you have the editor selected and the correct platform, and press run to start compiling and debug Godot. Now, this will take a long time the first time you do it. It heavily depends on the CPU and how many threads it has. On my very old CPU, it took me 29 minutes to finish the first time. But after that is done, the next time is much faster. It usually takes me 1 or 2 minutes when making changes to the code. And just to show why it takes so long, our original 200 megabytes of Godot files now has more than 7 gigs due to all of the linked static libraries created. But there is one last step before we are truly done. After it is done compiling, Godot will open the project window. If you open the project here, Godot will open the project in a new window, so our debug detaches and we can't use breakpoints anymore. To fix that, we are going to need to start the debugger directly inside the project. Open Project Properties, click on Debugging and change the Common Arguments field. Add a -e to start in editor mode, and add in --path, passing the path of your Godot project. Doing this, the debugger will now start with the project open, and we can use breakpoints again. And now you are free to code and debug Godot. One quick tip, if your machine is old like mine, it might take scones a few seconds each time you start debugging, even if you don't have any changes to your code. So if you need to run the same code again to debug something, you can go to Project Properties and change the build configuration to not build the project, and Visual Studio will now skip scones and just start debugging instantly. Just don't forget to re-enable it when you do make changes. It needs to recompile it again. Before we start exploring Godot's code, it is important to know the correct way to submit your modifications. So let's review the pull request and issues workflow that Godot uses. Like many open source projects, you need to create a pull request to submit changes. But for Godot, all pull requests also need to be associated with an issue first. You can't just submit any code and expect it to get accepted right away. So let's see how all of that works. If you want to fix a bug in Godot, first go to the issues page and search to see if the bug report for it already exists. If you see an issue with this symbol, it means someone already submitted a code fix for this. Sometimes it might also be a good idea to also search for closed issues. I've had times when the issue I reported has just been fixed a few days prior, and it was not in the latest public version or the one I had compiled. But if you don't find your issue here, you can create a new bug report. Make sure it is clear what's happening, and write simple steps on how to replicate the problem. After you have opened the issue, someone from the Godot organization will take a look at it and add tags. This usually happens very fast. I've had some issues tagged within minutes of it being created, but usually it takes less than a day unless it's on the weekends. The tags here are very important, and it tells you a few things. If your issue gets tagged with a needs testing, it means it is not easy to reproduce, and it may only affect some machines, and it needs testing to confirm it is really happening. If you got the bug label or the confirmed one, you are probably good to go. You might get some comments with other people's input on the problem, but at first glance, the issue is indeed happening. If you want to add something new instead, or make enhancements to Godot, you need to create a feature proposal instead. So go to the Godot Proposals project and create a new issue there. Briefly explain how it works and why it needs to be added to Godot core. On the second part, you'll be making a new feature to Godot to show step by step on how to do all of this work. But let's take a look at how the basic pull request workflow works for now. This is the most important part to get a feeling if your code is going to enter Godot or not. In the pull request description, you can use keywords like fixes or closes followed by the issue link. This will automatically link your pull request to the issue. It will display the issue on the side and will also close it when the code is merged. After the PR is created, someone from the Godot team will take a look at it, add labels, and request a review from a team member related to the changes. The important thing to look out for is the milestone tag. If you get the 4.x milestone, it will be added to the backlog. This doesn't mean it won't get accepted, but it means it is not a priority right now. If it is added to the next major version of Godot, you are in luck, and your changes are scheduled to enter Godot. It might take a while, or it might happen in days, but this milestone tag means it will eventually reach someone in Godot to accept the changes. So make sure your tests are passing, and you make any fixes requested before it enters beta, because when the beta phase starts, only fixes will be accepted, no more new features. So let's talk about tests. When you push your code to the site, a new GitHub action will automatically run all the tests in the cloud. And you can see the results at the bottom. If any tests have failed, you can click on them and see why. A test can fail for a number of reasons. I've had mine fail due to making API changes and not adding the documentation for it, or having my code not follow the clang format rules when I try to run Visual Studio without it. From this point on, you might get requested to make changes to your code, some questions about implementations, or even suggestions. Godot uses a single commit per PR, so to submit changes, you need to amend the commits and force push it to your branch. But don't worry, people can still see what changes between force pushes through GitHub. And now you just have to wait. It might take a while, but it will eventually get merged, and you can become a new Godot contributor. Before we create our new feature in Godot, let's briefly go over the code. One important method a lot of classes uses is the underscore bind method. This method is used to bind C++ functions so we can use the ng script or C#. When you make changes to the public API, you need to update the class reference docs, or the tests will fail, and your code will get rejected. Godot has a very easy way to update it. First, make sure you have compiled Godot after you make the changes to the bindings. After that, open the project folder and execute bin-godot.windows-editor-dev or whatever your executable is, --doc2. This will look at all the bindings and class references and update or create their documentation files. After it is done, you can use the git status command and see the files that changed or were added. Open it and describe the method you are exposing. This is the text that will appear when looking at the documentation inside Godot or the Godot doc site. So you can change this and run Godot to see how it looks inside. There is a lot of information on how to format it and how to highlight and give examples, if you need to. And that's it for the first part. A brief look on how to set up our dev environment, compile Godot, and how the pull request workflow works. On the next part, you'll be making a new Godot feature from start to finish. You'll be creating a new pull request and going through all the steps on how you can find things, where things are, and even work on fixing some unexpected bugs after receiving our code review. But that's it. I hope to see you on the second part. Thanks for watching, and until next time.